Wanna be a boss? You're watching Boss Up Houston Network. It's Boss Up Houston, where we look up, stay up, and boss up.
Roberta Washington. I am very, very excited about our show today. God is just truly so faithful. I have my amazing co-host with me, co-host Tony Caraway Smith. Today we will be talking about rising female leaders. And this is such an amazing subject for us to be talking about with everything that's going on in our nation right now. And so I am very, very excited. I'm excited today to be able to present some amazing, amazing, amazing leaders. These are female leaders that I admire and respect. And I am just, I'm excited about it. And so, but first I want my co-host to go ahead and speak to our audience on today.
Greetings, everybody. I hope everybody is having an awesome Sunday, and welcome to our beautiful guest today. And I just want everyone to be encouraged by this show today, and welcome.
Yes, thank you so much. I'm so excited. Everyone, if you want to go ahead and like, tag, and share, and start your watch parties, we are very, very excited. Again, this is the Promise TV show, and our scripture is 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, where the Bible says the promises of God are yes, and in him, amen. And that is a promise. Whatever God says to us is truly a promise. And I want to encourage us today, if you are a female leader, this is the day for you to chime in. This is the day for you to host a watch party. Go ahead and listen. Go ahead and look around in your messenger and on Facebook and tag you some senior leaders and tag you some girlfriends that you are, that you know are rising leaders at this time. We, the reason why I really wanted to bring these ladies on here, because there has been a great stigma as it relates to female leaders, and most importantly in ministry. Female leaders have been on the rise for years. We have been doing some amazing things. There are a lot of great female leaders in our nation, not just Black females, but just women in general. And this is a season where we are recognizing that a lot of women are rising. We are not going to be political at all, but I am going to, and because I can, I want to congratulate the VP elect, Kamala. I know that a lot of people are just going crazy about the elections and everything, but I think somebody told me a long time ago, it's a mighty poor dog that won't wag his own tail. And so I know that that's not so spiritual, but it is real. And we have the first African-American woman that is in line to be seated in the second position in the United States of America. And we would be remiss if we did not congratulate her. It has nothing to do with who you're voting for. You vote for whoever the Lord leads you to vote for, but I want to make sure that I am, that I definitely say congratulations to her. And so as we get ready to talk to these amazing guests, I first want our amazing guests to just introduce themselves to you. And so they can just give a little information about themselves. And as I said before, this is not the time for you to be modest, ladies. You are rising female leaders. I am very excited about what God is doing. So get excited, because I don't call myself a prophet, but I decree and declare and prophesy that you are rising even right now. And so I just want to first I want them to go ahead and give us a little information. We're going to go into our first question. So I want to start with this woman of God, who is someone who actually covers me as well in ministry. And so I know she looks very, very young, but I can call her mother. Amen. But I want to introduce. Listen, look, I got family. I got a lot. I'm going to call all of y'all my coverings today, because all of y'all are covering me. If you get looking prayer and everything else. So prophetess Shanita Jeffrey, if you can go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hello. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, woman of God. Again, my name is Prophetess Shanita Jeffrey. Who am I? I'm a servant of God. I'm a mother. I'm a wife. I'm a co-pastor. I'm an author. I'm a mentor. I'm a life coach. I'm a counselor. I'm just whatever God wants me to do. That's what I am. Amen.
Amen. And tell us about the church, the name of your church.
Name of my church is Outpouring Christian Fellowship, where we believe that when everyone walks through the door, that they feel love. Amen. Because God says if we have not love, we're like clashing cymbals. So I've always wanted people to experience love. Yeah, that right there.
Amen. Amen. And I want to go to our next esteemed guest. She is a co-pastor, and she's also she is a coach. Amen. And so I know that a lot of people don't, we don't want mentors. We don't want people, but the Bible says there's safety in the multitude of counselors. And I want to introduce to some and present to others. I want to call her Coach Tamara Randall. Am I pronouncing that right? Tamara or Tamara?
Nope, you're pronouncing it right.
Tamara, thank you. Okay.
Good evening, everyone. God bless you, Dr. Roberta, and co-host, I almost said co-pastor, Tony. Amen. I am Coach Tamara Randall, the entrepreneur coach. Come on, the co-pastor, the midwife, the author. Call me what you want to call me. Amen. I'm with a prophetess, a servant of God, and I am here to serve in the capacity of coaching. My specialty is coaching women entrepreneurs to helping them to be able to start their businesses and not only just start, but finish strong. There is so many other things that I do, but we'll just stop right there. Amen.
Amen. Well, to God be the glory, you all. I am excited. I love it. We'll give a little bit more information at the end. This woman of God, I just love her. Let me tell you something. When you meet people, the Bible says you will know them by their fruit. And when you meet people who truly have a heart for God, who are not in ministry just to be in ministry, but they know that God has called them, chose them, anointed and appointed them. She is an amazing woman of God, and she hails from San Antonio, Texas. And she is my sister in the ministry. And I want to say she is also covering for me as well. And I want to present to some, and I'm going to call her overseer. Amen. But she is a pastor, Angelique Monterio. If you can introduce yourself.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. I got the preach, sing voice, you know, after you sang hard or preached hard on a Sunday, and you got that little rasp that's going on with me today. But hey, my name is Angelique, and amazingly, it means God's messenger. So even when I was in my mother's womb, God was shaping my purpose. I say that I preach, I pray, I praise. I'm an intercessor, I'm a worshiper, and I thank God that he's allowed me to serve as the director of the Daughters of Promise, that I get to lead that ministry with the Full Gospel Baptist Church Fellowship International. So for the state of South Texas, I hold that position. I also serve as the assistant minister of music to be the wife of overseer AJ Monterio here in San Antonio, Texas at Victory Worship Center, where our mission, our vision is to win the world for Christ. We know that we're the hands and feet of Jesus. So I do whatever's needed to be done. I can serve behind the scenes. You don't even have to know I'm there. Or if you put me on a platform, I'll open my mouth because it's a leak and then I'm done. It's also an instrument. It's a French instrument. It's shaped like a woman's body. And when I got that revelation from the Holy Spirit, I told God, when I open my mouth, I'll say or sing or do whatever you want me to do. And he tells me, you're my mouthpiece. Let me play you. So that's my purpose. That's my role. And that's what I do. And thank you so much, Dr. Roberta, for inviting me here. I'm so honored to be with these esteemed guests today.
Amen. Well, I just say to God be all the glory. I want to jump right in into our first question, because I believe that it is important that our guests and those that are listening and watching, that they hear from us on today. So the first question that I have today for us is, how has your life changed since you have been in a leadership role? How has your life changed? And I'm going to go ahead and start with Prophetess Jeffrey. How has your life changed?
How did I know that you were coming to me first? Oh my gosh. Well, my life has changed drastically because the Holy Spirit governs me, right? So I'm no longer able to do the things that I used to do. And then when I do slip, he checks me quickly to make sure that I get it right. Amen. So I would say that's how my life has changed, because he controls my life. I don't control my life. I no longer live. It's he that lives on the inside of me.
Amen. And if we can just, I'm just going to flow in that vein. Coach Tamara, how has your life changed since you've been in this leadership role?
Boy, I got to tell you, you know, if I can be completely transparent this evening, I don't know any other way to be, but I wasn't a person that grew up in the church. I grew up in the streets. And so going into ministry, it was a different transition for me, because I did not know the church protocol, if you will. I didn't know the ways of the church. And so then when I came in, you know, I came in radical, and I came in ready, but I was on fire for God. And so in the beginning of ministry, I walked a lot in my feelings, and that's when I started going through trials and tribulations, and that transformed over to my faith. And once I started walking in faith, boy, I got to tell you, it was hard in the beginning, but to whom much is given, much is required. Listen, I'm the coach, but I'm the preacher too. So I'm with you, prophetess. Listen, you get that little voice going on, but I'm going to move on from there. But it's been many trials, but it's also been many blessings to be able to walk with the Lord. So I cannot complain. I cannot.
Amen. Well, go dive right on in there, Pastor Angelique. How has your life changed?
Sis, now you know. You know, I'm always telling you that God is stretching me. Like, I feel a constant stretch. I want to piggyback on what Prophetess Tamara said, that to whom much is given, much is required. Sometimes God pulls things out of me that I didn't even know was there, but I know it's only there because of the Holy Spirit, that He knows, God knows what He placed in each one of us. And our giftings are uniquely and creatively wonderful as He placed them there. We're not like anybody else. And He has to remind me that I'm never feeling like I'm in competition with anybody else, but sometimes I don't feel worthy. Sometimes I don't feel like I'm able to do it, but God just keeps saying stretch, and He's stretching me. So I just want to say that there's always a pull, and I'm learning how to balance that pull with family and kids and other responsibilities. Definitely a change. Definitely.
I do believe that. I mean, me myself, for as a female leader, it has changed me so much because it has grown me up. I am absolutely not the same woman that I was. I've been pastoring now. We just celebrated 9 years, so we're coming into the 10th year. And so being in this senior leadership role has challenged every part of me. Every fiber of my being has been challenged. I mean, it has, as I said, it will grow you up. It will grow you up to know that this is, it's a heavy weight. It's a heavy weight, and it, I want to say, if you question, whatever you question about your life, even salvation, it will check every box in your life to be in a senior leadership role. And then let me just say, because we have to be transparent. Also, I mean, I was attacked so much when God called me as a senior pastor, I was attacked. Because I'm a woman, and we come from, I was raised in the Baptist culture. So being raised in the Baptist culture, I was attacked by so many people. I was challenged. Every scripture that I put on Facebook was challenged by a man. And, you know, and how do you know that you've been called? And I was invited. I remember being invited on this. It was something, they said it was for prayer. It was a Nigerian man who I did not know inboxed me on Facebook and asked me, he said, would you please come on my prayer call that we're having this evening? Please, please, I beg of you. I beg of you. And so he invited me to come on. When I came on the call, you know, to my surprise, it was a call about leadership, and it was a call about who was called. And of course, they were the question was given to me. How did I know? Or why do I believe that God has called women to lead? And I was sitting there like, did he just actually do this? And so I said, well, I said, I know that you are looking for me to come back on you with that famous scripture in the Bible where in the last days, you know, my sons and daughters will prophesy. But how about I take you back to Genesis 1 and 26, when God said, let us make man in our own image. And in the likeness of God, he created us male and female, and he called us mankind. And the Bible is written in a male conversation. But when God says man, he's talking about all of us. I say, so how about we go all the way back there? And he said, wow. And I said, because I said, it's really foolish that you all are still having this conversation. I said, but a lot of what you're giving us was taught to you. It was not given to you by way of the Holy Spirit. And so I was challenged. I was challenged. And so I am a person who really and truly believes. And for me, I ran from it. I was like, God, did you know that I'm a woman? And he was like, I didn't know that. I didn't know that you were a woman. And he was like, no, of course not. And so I had to accept my calling. But we're going to go to a short break right now, y'all. We have a short break to go into, but we'll be getting started again in a couple of minutes and we will go on to our next question. So just, we're going to break right now as we go into our commercial. Thank you so much.
Thank you. You, who were formed by the heat of the galaxy. What a thing to be, both unique and familiar. To be one and the same. And still, unlike any other. Life is a set of choices.
Does your father know you are here?
Lead.
I laugh in the face of danger.
Or be led astray.
Run away and never return.
Follow your light. Or lose it.
You can't wear a crown with your head down.
The question is, who are you?
Don't know, but take my bow up.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we are back. And again, I want to just thank you all, ladies, for being here with us today. My co-host is going to dive right into the second question that we have for you ladies today.
I am so loving this, and I'm just so grateful to be on a panel with such some awesome women. And before I go there, I just want to say that I'm not in leadership, but because I've been challenged too, just listening to each one of your testimonies with me having a seventh grade education and getting my GED in my later 40s, and I was bound with fear, bound with insecurities. And look at me now, Boss Up Houston with Dr. Roberta Carter as a co-host. I've been probably a co-host for more than two years or so, but I want to give a shout out to Pastor Chris, because he gave me that opportunity to believe in myself when I first had my first radio segment, podcast, radio show, and he had a prominent doctor out of Sugarland that gave me confidence that I can do all things through Christ and give me strength. So I just want to thank Dr. Roberta Carter too for letting me have this opportunity in this panel to be a part of y'all today. But I wanted to say and ask you a question, and I'm assuming everybody's married here. How are you able to maintain a healthy marriage in having your leadership role, and how can you maneuver through that? Can y'all elaborate on that, being married and having such a leadership role that you have? And I guess we can start with you. Whoever want to start, just go ahead, and we would love to hear your comments.
Okay, I guess I'll go ahead and start first. Well, how do we create balance? Okay, at first, in the beginning of our marriage, there was no balance because my husband was the pastor already to a church. So it was all about the church. It was about the church. And we used to have feuds and argue a lot about it. And then thank God for our relationship that we both have, and me coming into it and gaining my relationship with Christ. And, you know, my plight to him was, you're always concerned about the church. You're always worried about the church. You're always worried about the church. But then God had to work on me, right, in order to work on him. Because, see, we'll go to God sometimes about our husbands, but then we really need to go to God about ourselves. Right. And so once he started working on me and tearing things off of me, then I understood the pastor, the shepherd's heart for the people. And so once I understood the shepherd's heart for the people, then he understood my heart. Then we started to come together. And so now how we create the balance, we spend time with each other. You know, we do vacations. We go places, because you need that time as husband and wife. I mean, you need that time even just from the family, the children. You need that time. So you have to date. You have to date. You have to keep the communication open. And so that's how we maintain our relationship, is that we spend time together. We communicate with one another. You know, we allow each other. We talk about what we feel, right? If I'm feeling some type of way, he knows how I'm feeling. If he's feeling some type of way, I know how he's feeling. So that, you know, there are less arguments. Amen. And so that's how we create the balance, is that we spend time, we go off, you know, with each other.
And what about you, Minister Randall?
Yes, I would. I guess I'm going to give a twofold answer. In the beginning, I will say this is that because I did not know a lot about ministry in the beginning of our marriage, and we planted a church. So that if you, those of you who have planted a church, you know how that is. It can be a very big strain on your relationship because you're taking your own finances, you're planning, so on and so forth. And so there would be a lot of mistakes made in the beginning. And I would always look at him as, Pastor, you shouldn't be doing this. Pastor, you shouldn't be doing that. Not really understanding that, hey, he was a man first. He was called second. And so then once I let that down to understand that he's not just only my pastor, but in who I serve in leadership with, but this is my husband. This is the man. Then things started to become a whole lot better. Because then we could be able to still balance out the two. Hey, we don't talk about church at the dinner table. We don't talk about church, you know, in the bedroom. Come on, I'm gonna keep it real tonight. We don't talk about, we're not talking about Kirk Franklin in the bedroom. You see what I'm saying? But what we, you know, and so we know where to cut it off. And we just create balance, like Prophet has said, and we take trips, we have vacations, and we cut up together, y'all. You know, my husband is a very quiet person, but he's a little quiet storm. He cuts up real bad. They think it's all me, but it's really all him. But so balance, I would say balance is definitely the key for sure.
Okay, Pastor Angelina.
I'm going to jump in and piggyback on what's been said. Definitely balance, but I also learned to establish boundaries, 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 boundaries. Somebody say boundaries. I feel like I might feel a preach on boundaries because the sheep are so used to being able, especially in a smaller ministry and a startup ministry, they're so used to having access to the pastors and they want it. They'll show up at your house if you let them. They'll call you all times of night if you let them. So I had to learn to turn my phone off at certain hours. And I laugh because many years ago, and I want to just say really quickly, we've been married for 28 years. And the first year into marriage, my husband partnered with a gentleman and they founded a church as a new bride. And, you know, so now that's Bishop Warren in Goldsboro, North Carolina. We're a military family, so we've traveled around and every place we've gone, either my husband was the pastor, the assistant pastor, the youth pastor. And I didn't start this pastoring thing until, 14 years ago, 12 years ago. So I'm a newbie at this. But all of that being said, we had to establish boundaries. That's number one. Number two, we had to realize also that we're both called and there are things that God gives us to do together as a couple, but there's also things that he gives us individually to do. And I had to learn to stop trying to beat my husband up to do things that God didn't tell him to do, but he told me to do. And likewise, he had to learn this is an AJ thing, not an AJ and Angelique thing. But then when we come together, we had to appreciate and support each other's giftings and callings and not allow, hear me now, not allow the sheep to cause competition to come in. I like the way she preached like this. And I like the way he says that he's a better teacher. She's a better preacher because the sheep will do it if we don't put them in check. I'm trying to tell y'all, I've been in this thing a long time. I'm a pastor's daughter too. So I saw my dad for 29 years deal with the sheep. And I learned then from watching my parents how important it is to keep the dates. So every quarter we take a trip, even if it's a staycation here in San Antonio, we just unplug and pull away. And then also every Friday, and our congregation knows this, every Friday is date night. Don't call us on no Friday. And if there's a church event, you might not get us. And if we adjust it, we're still going to get it in on a Saturday or a Sunday evening. It's just really important to have that one-on-one time. Ooh. So I'm going to stop there because I could go on about this, because another thing that we do is we have a marriage ministry called Together Forever, where divorce is not an option when we follow the plan that God has, that anything is forgivable if both parties are willing to work on it. It doesn't matter if it was infidelity, financial strain, anything is forgivable. Together Forever. Amen.
Wow. I can jump in there, Ms. Tony, and say that I believe that this is really a blessing for me. I'm now a newlywed. And so it's I think one of the greatest things that we do not recognize in ministry, especially as female leaders is that place of balance, because I can say for myself, for a number of years, I think that the enemy plants it in your mind that being romantic with your spouse is dirty. And so as when you're in leadership or when you're a woman in ministry, you really, most women really truly want to please the Father. That's the reality. Most women really truly want to please the Father. And so we tend to not know how to separate or to be able to be the preacher in the pulpit, but be the wife and girlfriend and all of that at home. And so a lot of times we don't know how to separate, you know, to separate from that, you know, from being able to be that wife. And so this, you know, with my husband, I've been doing everything that I can to try to make balance in the house. And what I love is that a lot of you have been married, all of you have been married for years. And I just want you to go back for a moment and just say how long you've been married. I want to go back to Pastor Angelique. How long have you been married?
So we've been together for 31 years, but we've been married for 28. So most of my adult life, I'm 52. So I've been with this man all of my adult life. But interestingly enough, you went there on the bedroom, because when we first got married, and I'm going to try to keep it PG and clean, but we have to be real in the body of Christ and talk about stuff. But I thought that there was only one way for me to lay. I'm really trying to clean it up, y'all. Just let the Holy Ghost, complete the sentences. Amen. But I thought there were only certain things I was supposed to do, right? Because we were taught to be chaste and you know, to not do certain things. Amen. But I needed to learn how to please my husband. So the first scripture he taught me, y'all, for real, he made me memorize the scripture. Hebrews 13:4, marriage is honorable above all, and the bed undefiled, meaning what we decide to do in our bed is our business. As long as we're not bringing other people and other creatures in the bed, it's undefiled. And we can have fun and enjoy one another, because God's design for sex was within marriage, and it's a good thing. That's God gave that gift to us. It's a gift, and we got to learn to embrace it and to cultivate that and build that foundation in marriage.
Wow, that was
so good. 28 years. 28 years.
Amen. Pastor Randall, how long have you been married?
So we've been together 12 years, married 11. And I'm going to have to piggyback on Pastor. Is it Angelique? Am I pronouncing that right?
Yeah.
Listen, Pastor Roberta, you're going to have to leave the hooping at the pulpit, the teaching at the pulpit. You listen, your hair get changed up. You in this time of marriage, you're going to become 20 different women. All I'm trying to say is flip from your braids to different wigs. I mean, you're going to turn into you have to turn into different, you know, I got my Erica Badu right now, but earlier, listen, I was somebody else. And so, you know, you got to act like stuff need to be fixed in the room. And, you know, I can go on. Call me offline, sis. Okay. 12 years. I'm putting on pause now. Prophetess, you up.
Oh, my God.
Amen. Well, I've been married 8 years now to Bishop Glenn Jeffrey. That's my boo, y'all. And we've been together for 10 years. Amen. I have to say my two cents, too, in all of this. Amen. When it concerns your husband, especially in the bedroom, ask him what he like, what he don't like. Because, see, that's important, right? Because you could be doing something that he don't even like, right? But make it known, honey, what you want. Amen. So I'm going to leave that alone. That's just a nudge.
No, I think, you know, all of this conversation is very, very important, because, again, it is the reason why most marriages fail. It is the reason why most marriages fail. I told Miss Tony every third Sunday of the month, we're going to start having a marriage. So I may be calling some of y'all in for guests, but we're going to have married couples and we're going to have real conversations, because what I believe is that one of the number one breakups in marriage is what's going on in the bedroom. But this is happening within the church, but it has become a taboo conversation. We don't want to talk about it. But okay, but there are people in the church that need to hear exactly what we're talking about right now. Some of you know, some of you don't know. My previous marriage, I was celibate in the marriage for 14 years. 14 years. 1-4. And so people are dealing with that and they don't want to talk about it because it's a sensitive subject. You don't want to ever embarrass the other person or whatever. And so, and then who do you talk to? Who do you talk to? You know, going through numbers of, you know, and people after so many years, when you're in ministry, people ask you the dumb questions as if you didn't do it. Well, have you gotten counseling? I am a pastor. Come on now. We went to 3 counselors. You know, it's like, you know, people start asking you the ministry questions when you do it all. You've done it all. And so some of it at times I'll say to a lot of some couples, it's fixable. Sometimes it's fixable. Sometimes it's not. We just have to make sure that we're in you know, in line with what God says. And so we're going to have those important conversations. And so before we go on to our next question, I do want to say to our listening audience, we do accept donations. And so she was going to put that on the screen, but I'm just going to give it to you. You can donate. You can go to $IWC Church Houston and you can donate to the ministry. And so that we can stay on air and we can stay live. So we are accepting donations. You can also go $Roberta, my first name, W-A-S-H, Wash, and you can donate there as well. But we do accept donations because we want to stay live, want to stay on the air, and we are excited because soon we will be on Roku TV. So if you notice that we are on so many different platforms, Apple TV, we're on Android TV, we're on Boss Up Houston Facebook and Boss Up Houston on YouTube. So we want to make sure that we are able to stay on these wonderful platforms. So I just put my little spiel out there, but it's $IWC Church Houston if you want to donate. And so I want to move on to our next topic because I think that this one is very, very important as well. And I want to ask our amazing senior leaders, do you believe that women in ministry that are now considered just as relevant as our male counterparts, or is the ceiling still there for women? Do you believe that we have become relevant at all? And I'm going to go to Prophetess Jeffrey and ask you that question.
Okay, yes, ma'am. I do believe that we are very much so relevant in this time. Amen. God says in the last day, I'm going to pour out my spirit on all flesh. Amen. So I definitely think that we are relevant. I do believe that we should have a covering. Amen. So as our husbands are our covering. Amen. But that does not determine whether we are prophets or pastors or, you know, evangelists, you know, but because God calls us. So it's important for the people of God that are listening to understand that God calls us into the position that he calls us in. Amen. So, yes, we are definitely relevant in this hour.
Amen. And I want to ask you the same question, Pastor Ronald. Do you believe that women, if I can just put a little spin on it, do you believe that we have become relevant? Because I know that for a long time, the stigma was, you know, and in some places, for example, in some missionary churches, we're still forced to speak from the floor and not in the pulpit. So can you speak to that as well? Do you believe that we're relevant, or do you believe that there's still this ceiling for women?
I believe that I think it's kind of a double-edged sword. I believe that we definitely are relevant. And I believe that is because women, we have begun to rise up and take our place in the kingdom of God. And so whether or not men wanted to give it to us or not, we took it by force, and we taking it by force right now. And so then with that being said, you know, there are some still churches that are still very deep in religion, if you will. And they'll still tell you, you know, they'll put that little black stand. Y'all know about that black stand. They'll put it right on the floor, and you'll be headed up to the pulpit, and they'll put that little black stand on the floor for you and tell you, no, sis, this where you're going to speak from. You know, so like I said, I think it's a double-edged sword, but I really do believe that, you know, it now is becoming a time that men and just period people are starting to, and even tradition is starting to now realize that the real Deborahs is starting to rise up, and we're going to take our mantle by force, whether you like Medea say, voluntarily or involuntarily, take your pick.
Amen. Go ahead. Oh, Pastor Angelique.
So I've been at this thing for a really long time, and I'll be honest and say God started dealing with me as a little girl in a traditional missionary Baptist church where my father was the pastor. The Holy Spirit would touch my mouth 9 years old, 5 years old, 12 years old, and I would stand up and say, God said, yada, yada, yada. Then I would sit down and cry. I would cry mainly because I felt like I was going to get in trouble because I had stood up and said something. When I knew that even as a young girl, I learned that women were not accepted in the pulpit. And I didn't have the wherewithal to know that God was calling me to preach as a young child. But what God would do, because I sing, is every time I get ready to sing, I would say something. And I was preaching a little sermonette without even realizing it. And I remember joining the military and going home on leave one time, and I was in my early 20s, and my dad said, I just want you to sing the song, don't preach a sermon. And that was when it hit me like, oh, that's what I've been doing all these years. I didn't even know. And I'm saying that because your gift will make room for you. Didn't need a title. I didn't need a platform. I just, whatever opportunity God gave me, when I opened my mouth, what was in me came out, and that was which was quickened in my spirit by the Holy Ghost. And so learning from my dad that I was not going to be accepted as a preacher early on, when we would get stationed at different bases, and I'm trying to move quickly, we would get these invitations, and I would just honor whatever the house said. Right. If they told me to stand on the floor, I wouldn't even ask to go in the pulpit. They would give me to speak, you know, Women's Day, Choir Day, you know, Us Today, that kind of stuff. And I would just ask, where do you want me to stand? Where should I be? And then when the door opened, I would just walk in it. And what happened is, even in traditional places, when I would get invited back, the pastor would say, you come on up, you come on up. And so seriously, that scripture, your gift will make room for you. I've seen it just break forth in my life. So to answer the question, I do believe women in ministry are so incredibly relevant. I also know there's still some places where, because of tradition, we are not accepted. I'm telling you, just when the door is open, you don't have to bust your way. And I do believe I'm not contradicting what Pastor Tamara said, because I know some things in warfare, you got to take it by force. I hear you, sis. But I also know that sometimes the Holy Spirit has had me to just be quiet. And this is what people say often. You are a quiet storm. You're a quiet storm because you'll sit there quiet. I didn't even know you had that in you. I didn't even know you was called. I didn't even know why, because I've just learned to just assess the environment. And when the Holy Spirit tells me now's the time, I jump in, do what I got to do, and bounce out.
Wow. Well, I definitely agree with all. I agree with all of it. I just know that we are in a time where a great shift. I believe the pandemic has caused so much. And most importantly, I believe that the pandemic has also brought us to a place where God is, this is to me, it's called, I call it the great reveal. And so God is revealing so much right now during the midst of this pandemic. It has not just been about the pandemic itself. It's been the George Floyd movement. It's been the Breonna Taylor movement. It's been now we have Kamala Harris. It's so much that's being revealed right now. And I'm just calling this the great reveal. So what I would say to us is that I believe that the ceiling that has been there, I believe that there's potential. I'm gonna say it like that. I believe that there's potential. I believe that we deserve a seat at the table, and I believe that we deserve a seat at the pulpit to be able to preach the gospel the way God has given it to us to preach it. And so we all just have to I would say also like Overseer Monteria said, you also have to just be mindful of how I think that the greatest indictment against us is not necessarily whether or not we can sit at the table, but I think we've never trained ourselves how to sit at the table. And so we have to understand that there's protocol in everything. So protocol cannot be breached. And so we're going to go ahead and go into another. We're going to go into a commercial break, and then we're going to go into our final question. And so, again, I'm very excited. Look, y'all are blessing some people. I don't know if you check in your live and seeing what your guests are saying. If you have a guest that has a question or a comment and you want to, please let me know so that we can answer their questions. Because there are some female leaders out there that are saying, how can I do this? I want to do this just like them. And so I want to make sure that we answer the questions that are coming to us, especially those questions for the women, the married women. Listen, they have some questions. So we're going to go ahead and break. Amen. So y'all stick with us. We'll be right back.
Devin, did you know GEICO is now offering an extra 15% credit on car and motorcycle policies?
Okay.
That's 15% on top of what GEICO could already save you. So what are you waiting for? DJ Khaled to be your motivational coach?
Yo, Devin, remember to brush in a circle motion.
Thank you, DJ Khaled.
Tiny circles, Devin. Do another one. Another one.
Is this good?
Put in that word, Devin. Don't give up.
GEICO. Save an extra 15% when you switch by October 7th.
Don't play yourself. Hit subscribe to play more great GEICO videos. And don't forget to share.
Kevin, did you know GEICO?
I want to give you the opportunity to tell your truth. So let's start with what happened.
This is Red Table Talk.
Red Table Talk.
Red Table Talk. This table carries no judgment.
I suffered trauma at an early age.
This table brings out your truth.
I had to hit rock bottom. I had to lose everything.
This table encourages you to share your story.
I was just caught up in that pain.
This table has room for everyone.
For everyone.
Red Table makes you emotional.
When there's a lot of love there, there's always a path towards healing.
Intimate, provocative, unfiltered.
Join us. Take a seat at the table.
Only on Facebook Watch.
Amen. We are back. Amen. And again, I want to say we are having a wonderful conversation with these amazing rising women leaders, and they're already in their leadership role. And I just want to say again that the conversation has been so wonderful. It's juicy and good. And I want to make sure that again, did anyone get any questions out there? Did any of you get any questions or comments that you want to say? Even before we go into the last, does anybody special out there you want to shout out to? As we go into our final question or topic here, and I'm going to allow my co-host to go ahead and bring that final question for us.
I want to go back to Pastor Angeline. You had made a comment about being concerned as a female minister being accepted. I wanted to ask you, how do you feel? Of course, we know that we have a female VP now. So how do you feel how it would affect women, how women are viewed now at this point?
Awesome question about how do we feel about current VP-elect Kamala Harris? How do I feel about that? I had to pause really quick. I'm a numbers girl. And so I took a look to see that for the 2020 primary, we're all in Texas. And right now, women voters in Texas outnumber men by 12%, right? There's 9.3 million women who are registered to vote, 8.3 million men. And so we have a voice. And I think what's going to happen with this election, we saw it in the runnings, because remember, she was running for president. But now that she's on the ticket, on the Democratic ticket, we're going to get a chance to really see women rise up, to support her. They already are, because women of color can relate to her. Just women in general can relate to her. It seems that she's going further than other candidates have gone. Even though we know we had Hillary Clinton and we had Sarah Palin, there's something different and unique about her. So I really believe that is going to change the infrastructure even of our government. I really do. I even looked back on history with Shirley Chisholm back in the 70s. She ran for president back in the day, but Kamala Harris has a great backing behind her. And I think it's going to cause us to support one another better. I think it's going to cause us to speak well of each other better. Because if y'all notice in the media, some of the media outlets are trying to attack her character about past things that she's done, you know, past failures or past shortcomings, misgivings. And that's what happens often, right? And Satan is the accuser of the brethren. But it seems like when somebody's rising to the top, somebody else is trying to pull them down. But what I really see is women rallying behind her and a sisterhood coming together in this nation like we've never seen before.
That's good. Minister Jeffrey, how you feel that women would be viewed?
Well, when I look at it, I look at it as a spiritual thing, because it was a woman that led Barack, okay? It was a woman that prepared Jesus for what he was about to go into. So women have been, you know, on the back burner a long time, but they've been pushing men into their purpose for a very long time. So right now, I believe that she's going to push Biden into his purpose.
All right, Minister Randall, your point of view on that.
You know, prophetess, I need you to quit looking at my notes tonight. Amen. I believe that, you know, the VP-elect, Ms. Harris, what I like most about her, and it reminded me a lot, and we'll go spiritual with this, is that if she reminded me a lot about Deborah, because Deborah was in the judicial system, she was a judge. And Kamala is a former prosecutor. She's a lawyer, you know. And so what I look at when I look at Kamala is I look at this. I look at, like you said, she's a motherly. Deborah was a motherly figure. And we can look at Kamala as being a motherly figure as well. And so in this hour, I just really believe that she is going to rally up women to just rise up and really take their place. I pray that there will be justice served through her. She will come and bring balance. She will bring balance, like you were saying, to Biden. And I just really believe that she will bring more wisdom to him. She will invoke more wisdom to him. But we need women are a little bit more practical as far as our thinking is concerned. And I pray that as far as her background is concerned, her justice background is concerned, that she will not only lead from a justice standpoint, but she would also lead with a servant's heart. As women, we are a little bit more, again, a little bit more tender. We're a little bit more practical, but then she has that judicial in her. So she's going to come out, you know, like, hey, no, that's wrong. That's right. You know, so hopefully she will invoke justice, because that's, and she will put some integrity back into the White House, because that's what we're missing right now. We're really missing integrity. We're missing the integral act of our leaders. And so we're missing proper leadership. And I believe that she will add a great balance.
Wow, that is absolutely amazing. Listen, I am just in awe of all of this. For my response to the last question, I was watching a video where a minister, he is a minister from probably 30 years ago, who had a sermon 30 years ago, and it was just posted on Facebook on someone's page, and they started sharing it like crazy. But he said that a woman carried the living word, and now we don't want to allow women to carry the preach word. And that just absolutely blew my mind, just to hear him say that, because it is absolutely true. A woman carried the living word. The living word. The word was carried by a woman first. First, the woman carried the word in her womb first. And now women across the world have been stigmatized for a long time about carrying the preach word. And he just blew my mind with that analogy, because it is so real. It is so true. And I just believe that I just want to say that her being in that position, we're not God, so we don't know what God is going to allow to happen. We're just going to continue to pray. But what I say is her even being put in that position, I believe that it has given other women confidence. It's given them courage to move forward. It's almost like the Me Too movement. It took one or two women to step out and say that they were sexually harassed or someone touched them inappropriately in the workplace. It took a couple of women to stand up and say, I'm not going to be quiet. I'm not going to be silenced. I'm no longer on mute. Like a woman of God wrote the book, I'm no longer on mute. This is happening to us in the workplace. And those couple of women, those three women that came out, which were actually African-American women, started a Me Too movement across the country of women saying, this happened to me too. And so I believe that her stepping forward, if nothing else, I believe that it gives other women the confidence, the encouragement to say, you can be what God says that you can be. Whether it's in the pulpit or whether it's owning your own beauty salon, whether it's owning your own cosmetic line, whatever it is, you can be whatever God says you can be. And you are not limited by your sexuality and how far you can go. And so that is why I'm so excited to have all of you female leaders here, because you're doing amazing things in your community. And I believe, just like you said, one of you have said, that this is also an opportunity. We don't have to be AKAs, but I believe that this is an opportunity for women to unify, for us to rally behind each other, regardless of your race, rally behind each other and say, you are my sister. We have that saying, am I my brother's keeper? But I'm here to say today, are we our sister's keeper? We don't drag each other down, put each other down. Like I said one time on Facebook, when people consistently will question you about your life and what you're doing, and I said, I can't tell you everything on social media. All I can say is God knows my history. And so we have to be women who will rally behind each other, grab them by the hand or hug them or whatever, and say, I am my sister's keeper. Whatever you're going through, I got your back. Whatever you're going through, I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you. It's just like Jesus told Peter. He said, Peter, I'm praying for you. He was saying, Peter, you're equipped and you're already ready to beat this devil. And I'm not going to do this for you this time, Peter, but I'm praying for you that your faith fail you not. I'm praying for you, Peter, that your faith fail you not. And I say that to us women, that's what God is saying to us, that our faith fail us not. And whatever we're doing, whatever endeavor we're taking on, that our faith fail us not. So I just want to thank y'all so much for being a part of this conversation on today on the Promise TV. We are just so excited. My co-host messaged me. She said, this is so amazing. And it is. It is so amazing. And I'm so glad that none of you are afraid to step out there and encourage another sister and just be there at a time like this where women are rising. And so I love to close out in prayer. We're going to close out in prayer. If anybody has any questions, if you need to talk to one of these amazing women, I want to say again, I call them all mentors to me. And so I will say again, there is safety in the multitude of counselors. If you need to go to somebody, if you need encouragement, you're going through in your marriage, grab another sister, especially a sister that's been there, that's been married for years, and say, hey, I'm going through this. How do I get through this? How do I make it out of this? I don't want to tear down the ministry, but I'm about to go off, you know? So we want to make sure that we can encourage you, because y'all, listen, it ain't that easy every day. We are human. We are flesh. Jesus. And so let me pray us out, y'all. We're going to close here. But Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, and we honor you. We give you glory because you're worthy to be praised. Father, you are truly the author, the finisher, the creator of us, God. Father, I thank you, God, because God, as women, we were not just created. We were not formed. The Bible said you fashioned us. God, you took your time on us, God. And so, Father, there is something intricately made in each one of us, the power to produce. There are some women out there that says, but I'm barren. I haven't had any children. But I want to say today, there is creativity in you. There is the power to produce in you. And I just want to say, God, we thank you today. I pray for every sister, God, regardless of where they come from, their background, nationality, whatever country they came from, God. And I want to say, God, that we are our sister's keeper. And I encourage them on today, God. Father, we pray today that you will encourage the women, God, especially the single mothers, God, that are out there right now, lost their job, looking for a place for their children. And Father, we pray, God, your strength and your covering over them. Now, Father, we thank you today and we praise you. We lift your name on high, God, and we give you glory. We take no credit, God. We send the glory back to you in Jesus' name. We pray. Amen. And again, I just want to thank y'all for being a part of the Promise TV. I want to just shout out to the host of Boss Up Houston, Miss Minister Shamir Bacon, for all of that she has done and all that she's doing in the community. And so we're closing right here. God bless you. We love you. And remember that 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20 said, the promises of God are yes, and in him, amen. Amen.